Team Canada, you need this man on your team. This is the Outside Gate with Steve Hall on the L4 Media Network, talking US moto and anywhere the conversation goes. Today we're joined by Geoff Klassen from GPMoto. There he is. How are you, man?
Hey, I'm great. How you doing, Steve?
Yeah, good, man. Thanks for joining us. So GPMoto, dude, I think we'll dive straight in and just you give yourself a bit of an intro about you and your business.
Well, it started out, I think, like every other kid who dreamed and aspired of riding dirt bikes. And my first job when I was 14 was in a dirt bike shop. And it just kind of spiraled from there. When you turn 16, you get super interested in cars and trucks, right? You get your driver's license. So the love for dirt bikes waned a little bit, but as you get older, you get back into bikes. And I don't know, I bounced back and forth from the automotive as an automotive tech, did my apprenticeship and worked back and forth between some bike shops and automotive shops. And then back then, motorcycle techs weren't getting paid very much at all. So it was pretty tough to, you know, you could make 80 grand a year in a car dealership or make, I don't know, 30 or 40 grand a year as a motorcycle mechanic. So I figured the only way that I would ever do it and make some money is if I did it by myself. And so that is where GPMoto came from, 2009.
Beautiful, man. Beautiful. Yeah. And GPMoto is based in, British Columbia.
Yeah. West coast of Canada. Right. You betcha. Yeah. A city called Kamloops. So we're about 3.5-4 hours northeast of Vancouver. So
cool, man. And I know you post bits and pieces all over the place. I know you definitely post some bits and pieces to California because you just sent some down to old Toolman Dan for the Green Honda. How far do you ship and that sort of thing? How wide is your customer base?
My customer base is pretty local. I do have some customers on the east coast of Canada, about 4,000 kilometers away. I got a few guys through like Main Event Moto and through podcasts that we have this population of riders in. I've made connections with guys who have got some suspension work done for me, so I've sold them some stuff. And then I get guys like TMD and you and I don't know, all over the world that I just want to send stuff to. So every now and then I do up a package and ship it out. And yeah,
that's the way. And man, like I said, like my opening words, Team Canada needs you, huh? They got to get you on.
Oh my goodness!
I reckon that the motocross of nations could have been completely different if GPMoto had been involved.
I don't know.
They got to get you. They got to hire you as like suspension tech and fucking chief of morale and all that sort of thing.
I don't know what the answer is there. That was, could you imagine if USA, well, even let's back it up. So let's say Australia sent Jet and Hunter and Chad Reed in his prime. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you have the best three guys in Australia. Your expectation would be a podium, realistically. Like, we can do this. This is a total realistic outcome. Yeah. And if they don't even make the B final, you're a little upset, right? So yeah. We got Jess Pettis, Dylan Wright, and Ryder McNabb. And these guys are all like championship title winning guys. There's no excuses. This is the best Canada has to offer. I'm sorry. Like, I love Jess Pettis.
Team, the best team that was ever sent by Canada? Like,
I mean, I don't know about ever, but Dylan's four-time 450 champ. Jess is two or three-time second behind Dylan. And in my opinion, he just hasn't had a really healthy season to give Dylan a run for his money. I put them on equal caliber. And Ryder McNabb's young, and he's, you know, was arguable. I think last year they sent Jacob Piccolo instead. But Jacob Piccolo or Ryder McNabb are both phenomenal lights riders. So in my opinion, these guys are like top 10 guys. Like, a realistic outcome in the A final would be somewhere in the 6-8 position is real. And they didn't even make the B final. Like, it was, I don't know.
Even, at some even point, with my, even with my limited knowledge of Canadian moto, you know, like all I really know of it, I guess, is I've listened to a few times the guys that get on Pulp, you know,
Ryan and Goldie.
Goldie and Noof. They seem like good cats, those two, and they come on and talk about it. And then obviously, yeah, I know Dylan Wright, but he had an undefeated season last year, I think, and then only lost one race this year or something like that. Mm-hmm. Does that sound right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Goldie and Noof, a good couple of cunts.
yeah, which one of them got absolutely fucking smashed at the Redbud Nations on the day of the pit bike race?
That was probably Goldie. Story.
That was a funny story. That was an absolute classic hearing about that. Yeah,
neither one of them are afraid of beer.
Yeah, one of them was supposed to race the pit bike race. You know, the pit bike race that Bidas organizes.
Yep.
And he was too fucking drunk. He was too drunk to write. I think I'd have to go back and listen. They did a show on it. Yeah.
Those are the times that the stories and that nothing does it justice. Like, you had to be there.
Yeah, yeah. And I think people were like just feeding him drinks over the fence and all that.
Yep. But Goldie and Noof both, they take it up to an 11 every time. Like, never a dull moment.
If that happened in Canada, would that be like, how would that be looked at if that happened in Canada?
Normal.
If a guy was like smashed and got into a peat bike race at a big event, mm-hmm. would that be like frowned upon?
It's okay. Nope, yeah. Not really.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. That's it. That's one thing, like, people think Australia is pretty cool and all that, but seriously, if somebody was even fucking seen with a fucking drink in their hand and then getting on a bike, even for a pit bike race, it would be fucking, it would be a massive shit show at an event in Australia. They'd probably be, them and their family would probably be fucking kicked out and fucking banned and all this sort of stuff. Like, we're so fucking strict here with so many things like that, you know?
Interesting.
I look at things like Europe's even more loose, you know. Like, I love, I always watch Erzberg. I don't know heaps about it, but I love it. It's my favorite thing to watch that's not like a US, like that's not an AMA event. The next favorite thing, I love Erzberg and that thing they do the day before the event starts,
the prologue.
Nah, even before, where they all just ride their fucking race bikes and into fucking town.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yep.
They're all like, they doing jump on their race bikes and the mechanic's on the spare bike and the girlfriends are on the back and they all fucking ride through the middle of the town there at Erzberg. And then they, you know, all that sort of thing. That's fucking like,
it's good.
Yeah, you'd need like 17 fucking different permits, like triple stamped.
Yeah, but how many people are there? How many thousands of people, hundreds, if not thousands, are on bikes and riding around?
Yeah.
And you tell me how many incidents there are, how many people die or get injured or zero.
Yeah.
So, like, it's fine.
I know.
People need to chill out a bit.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, that's it. Well, you would need, you know, miles of red tape to go through to do something like that in Australia, and it wouldn't even be in the end, it wouldn't even be worth it. Mm-hmm. But anyway, that's another rant for another day.
I got a question for you quick about MX.
Yeah, man.
Of Nations. Yep. So yes, when you were talking with Brody, our boy, Brody Richards, what about somebody you didn't talk about for Australia is Luke Clout. And I don't know enough about Luke Clout. Do you know much about him?
Cool, man.
Is he not a contender skill-wise? That could he not?
Not this year, no. So Cloudy had it would have been just last year. Cloudy had a really bad broken leg. Like, man, it was wicked. He came off. He basically traveled up and up ramp Without his bike, his body went all the way up and up ramp. That's was a high speed section, and he sort of it was sort of a tank slapper slash high side sort of setup, and he got fucking thrown and bounced all the way to a top. Anyway, and he broke his leg really bad. Okay. Long recovery, and then he also was just so terrible prep for this year, and then also broke his elbow, wrist. He winged himself anyway at some stage this year, which just put him like way behind. So his top end is there with Ferris's, you know.
Yeah,
but bad injury, and I think too, you know, getting his head right after that crash, probably a little bit of effect there too. But I believe he's switching teams. There's a bit of silly season stuff going on in Australia as we speak. So
is Penrite still involved or no?
Yeah. Oh, so cool. Penrite, I don't know. Do you guys have Penrite oils in North America?
No.
No, yeah.
Not with the presence that you guys have.
Yeah, because the brand started in Australia. Interesting fact, my dad was a Penrite dealer back in, he would have started selling that. It was a rare thing to be a Penrite dealer in mid-80s.
Mm-hmm.
And people were like, you know, what's this stuff? You know, it was a very sort of niche brand, really sort of roots in vintage cars and motorsport and that sort of thing. And they were real old school like that. They were many years after the other brands before they'd go near synthetic. It was all old school stuff. And now they're just massive and in everything. But yeah, they sponsor the series, but they also sponsor Brett Metcalf's team.
Oh, so nice.
Meaty, who you spent plenty of time in Canada after...
In Kamloops here.
Yeah.
This is where he was based out of when he rode for Kawasaki.
Yeah, cool. So Meaty's got his own team, has had for 2 years now. Mm-hmm. And so running KTMs and... they're running... There's a couple of different brands, I think, but he's running a KTM and Penrite sponsored. And they are wicked-looking bikes too. The best looking bikes in the pits, because you know that Penrite color, that the black, red and gold and all that. Yeah, the really good looking bikes. He's running that and he's still going around, you know. He's still he hasn't won for a couple of years. He hasn't won for the last two seasons. He hasn't had a win, but it wouldn't surprise you, especially on his home track, if he just won one next year, you know. He's still good, like always, sort of most of the time nowadays, the fifth, sixth guy. Mm-hmm. But pretty stacked field in the Aussies though, you know.
Yeah.
Especially with Jed Beaton coming home, Ferris coming out of retirement, Tanti really at the top of his game.
Mm-hmm.
I believe Tanti's going to the US I'm not sure if it's a rumor or if it's a lock, but I think he's going to be riding for PRMX.
Nice. On a Yanny.
In the States. I think, PRMX, aren't they Cowie?
Cowie. I'm thinking Club MX. Yeah. They just re-upped with Yamaha.
Yeah, well, Club, yeah, PRMX. If he could have got into Club, that would be awesome because he's coming straight off Yamahas.
Yeah.
But, Cowie's a good bike. So, hopefully that goes well for Tandy, because like he's a really good dude too, really really likable guy. So
nice.
Yeah, man,
that's good.
Yeah.
Sweet. I feel like Maddie would be similar. I'm not saying the same, but similar to Noof. Noof is, you know, a vet, ex-pro, and just so efficient at riding the bike. Like there's no wasted energy. And it's just super smooth. The pace is still there. It may not be the fastest guy on the track, but just always there, gets the job done. I don't know. I like watching those guys ride.
One thing about Meddy, that probably the main thing that I noticed, Oh, could you hear the Colonel?
Oh, yeah. He wants to chime in.
You know, every episode when I listen to the playbacks and that, he's sneaking them in the background. But once it's all done and that, you know, but any episode, if you listen carefully, the Colonel, he's only
fuck
about
you, I'm the boss, he says.
He's only about, I guess, in your measurement, he's about 50 feet away from where I sit. So, and there's a couple of walls. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he makes his presence known pretty regularly. So, but yeah,
it's good. You got to embrace that.
Hey,
you got to embrace that. It's part of the show.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I need to get him in the yard, just straight out my window, just here one day. And then you'll hear him for sure.
Yeah.
But one thing about Medi, that I always notice, Medi in practice, he's always looking for lines. Whereas, you know, like you'll get, you know, I think that's a real experience thing, you know, especially like you'll get, you know, Cloudy, Tandy, those guys, it's just fucking into it, you know. Medi, the first few laps of practice, he'll be searching and he's always sort of looking for different lines, especially inside lines, things where he can cut down. It's like he's going around looking for opportunities.
Yeah,
in practice. That's something that I often see him do. Yeah,
it's a vet thing, right?
Yeah. Rather than just got to get this qualifying time, it's like, you know, what else? What else have we got here? You know, is there another little rut inside the main rut? Is there, you know, where can I pass? You know, this sort of thing.
And that's classic really. Valentino Rossi. He'd spend all qualifying in 18th, 20th, and you're like, what the fuck's going on? Why is like, and then all of a sudden, last couple minutes, same thing. He's just scouting lines, and then he'll put a heater down and he's top three on the board. And it's like, oh, okay. Yeah, he knows what he's doing.
Yeah. I don't know much about the old MotoGP, man. Yeah. I know Rossi. I haven't followed it closely since Stoner retired.
I don't blame you.
You know, that was sort of like, you know, he was gone. But also, too, the reason I used to follow that is because we couldn't fucking watch Moto here. Mm-hmm. There was fucking nothing. Like, there was, you'd catch a supercross on YouTube on some dodgy hack. And we couldn't watch the outdoors at all, and unless you had a even dodgier streamer or something, which I had some dodgy dude from South America that I used to watch the Nationals on, and every year he'd have a different name. You'd have to sort of find him again and then watch his stream. But now, we get it. It's only the last few years we've been able to actually get everything. So,
how far are you from Phillip Island?
Sorry, man.
How far are you from Phillip Island?
Phillip Island is about 4.5-5 hours.
Mm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Sort of straight south. So Phillip Island is right off. It's off the very south of Melbourne. Phillip Island is off the very south of Melbourne, basically.
Yep.
There you go. Right down there. I've been there. Been there lots of times for lots of different things. I've been there. I've driven race cars around there. I've been there to watch race cars. I've never actually been there to watch the bikes. But I've been to Phillip Island just for holiday, and I've been there fishing trips. It's a ripper spot, you know, even if the track wasn't there. So, and that whole sort of little part of the world, the track that you might hear of called Wonthaggi, that is usually the opening round of our Nationals.
Mm-hmm.
It's reasonably close. It's down that sort of same sort of area there. Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah. Cool, man. I'm going to ask you some questions, some suspension questions.
Let's
about about your business.
Yeah.
First one, man, is I know I'm very much guilty of it, but it's got to piss you off, man, some of the absolute shit shows of forks and shocks that come in that are just fucking haven't had the oil changed in forever and are just absolute pile of shit. I'm fucking guilty of it myself. And I remember, like, my guy here, I apologize. I just say, look, I'm sorry, dude, this is going to be shit. You know, I know. Yeah, you must get some pretty crook ones.
Yeah, yes and no. It's not frustrating unless it's done out of sheer neglect. Like, if it's just sheer ignorance, they don't know any better, then it's, I always enjoy educating my customers and explaining to them why it's important. And even if they don't even understand what I'm talking about, I love to just show them the inner workings of their forks and shocks. And that way they're going to pick up either two things. They might understand what I'm talking about and retain it, or they'll realize that they have no fucking clue what I'm talking about, and that it's best they just bring it to me when I say, to ensure that it keeps working good. And usually when you have a fork or shock that's that deteriorated, or the oil is that bad, once you service it and get it back to where it should be, even the biggest hack will notice an improvement in the performance of it and go, oh, okay, yeah, this, I need to do this more often. So
yeah, because like myself, and I mean, I'm a big, I represent a big section of the market, you know, like old blokes that are just ride heaps, you know, you put heaps of hours on your bike, and you're super low budget, you know, and you're just pumping out hours on your bike. And, you know, it comes down sometimes to like, well, I know I've got to change the engine oil, and I know I've got to change the chains and sprockets. The suspension could just wait, and it could just wait a little bit more, and just wait a little bit more, and then you know it's going to be total shit. And then every time you get it back, and you're like, "Oh fuck, how good is this?" You know, my God, what was I doing? You know, like this thing is like so comfortable. But,
So where's the fail then? Like, where is it? Like, it's one thing if you know it, that you should have serviced it sooner, but the first time that happens, I feel like there's a huge disconnect on the salesman, on the sales floor level, that when you get sold a bike, they never, I mean, I've worked in lots of dealerships.
Yeah.
They don't take the time with the customer. They don't set SAG with the customer. Like, they don't bring the bike in the back and at least set SAG with them. They don't tell them anything about suspension. And so they all get blindsided. Literally, most people, the first time they ever find out about when they should be servicing their suspension is the first time their fork seal leaks and they bring it in to have a fork seal changed. And then they'll have that conversation about, oh, you should be doing this every 70 hours or 50 hours or whatever your interval is that you guys decide upon, right?
We're getting close to another rant here, but I think big, you know, you'd have them there everywhere. You really big dealerships, they're just pumping out bikes. They don't give a fuck about that, you know. They don't give a fuck.
Side by sides and ATVs.
If I tend to always, wherever I've lived, I'll seek out a small dealer that's fucking really good bloke, and I'll be loyal to them. Yeah. And all those situations when I've bought a bike, I've only ever bought one brand new bike, but I'll get a secondhand bikes through those guys. And I've been in their workshops, that sort of thing. And all those little things, they grease a thing probably before the customer gets it.
Mm-hmm.
They will tell, like when I did buy my new KX, they said, look, this thing comes with a shit chain because Kawasaki stock chains are garbage. They said, that'll 100%. Be just go and wear it out. You know, you might as well, but it'll be fucked in no time. And just know that you're going to want to put a chain on it soon. They gave me a pep talk about the suspension, you know, the old, just ride it for a start. So you got a bit of a base of how you feel about it, and let it wear in a bit and get a bit of a base how you feel about it. And then you want to get it, you know, set up and that sort of thing. And, just greasing the back end, all those different things that, your big sort of your fucking Walmarts of bike dealers.
They don't tell you.
They're just fucking pumping them out. You know, like I've had some experiences in some big bike shops. honestly, what I used to do when I lived on the edge of Melbourne, and that's what a lot of people do. You go into some of these big box stores and you'd fucking pick out everything that you want and you'd try everything on. And then you go to your little dealer that looks after you and you'd say, all right,
order it up.
This helmet fitted great. These boots are great and all that. And one story that I always use as an example of your big box dealer. And look, this, I'm pissing people off, but whatever. There's probably some big box dealers out there with a fucking good owner that trains the staff properly. So I'm probably casting a shadow over all of them, just on my experience, which isn't fair. But when Toby Price, the first time he won Dakar, right, that was a fucking big deal. No matter what sort of bike you rode, whether you're into moto, road, off-road, fucking anything, like everybody knew that Pricey won Dakar. That was massive, a massive achievement. And at that same time, we had a guy from the club was going around all the dealerships asking them to hand out flyers for an event. And he's just making small talk. And he went to the parts counter at this big dealership and just making a bit of small talk and can you hand out these flyers? And any of that, of course, they were happy to do that. And he goes, oh, how about Pricey? Hey, fucking hell. And they're going, oh, what happened? And it's like, Toby Price. And it's like, oh. And they just got this blank look. And it's like, you know, Toby Price. Nah, I'm not sure who he is. And this was the week after.
just turn around and leave.
That was just, couldn't believe it when this guy came and told us at the club, and he was just like, yep, they'd fucking, that's what you get there, you know?
Yep.
Someone that's probably, they've probably been selling fucking, you know, parts at a Ford dealership, and they come over to, you know, sell motorbike parts. They can remember part numbers and look stuff up, but yeah. So that's
it. It's unfortunate.
You know, man. And you know, none of those bikes are getting greased and they don't know anything about their suspension and all that sort of stuff, man. What about, dude, when you get a guy come in, like a lot of the population, I guess, of average Joes. So I've come up with these questions. So there's a lot of average Joe questions in this.
Perfect.
Because I asked out for questions on Insta and all that, didn't have any luck. So I don't have any fast guy questions for you. But there's a lot more average Joes out there than fast guys anyway, hey? So yep. A lot of average Joes love a track day and run it a bit of moto, and they also love to get out the bush as well and do a bit of trail riding and a bit of exploring or off-road racing. What's your thoughts on that? Like finding a bit of if you would have set up bikes where you've got to find a bit of compromise with the suspension setup.
I think it's all about, again, back to what I said earlier about educating your customer. So if you can explain to them that, if you could imagine like a teeter-totter or pendulum, if you have plushness over square edges for your off-road settings, but then you have resistance to bottoming over here for when you're jumping or riding the track, one comes at a cost of the other. So as long as they understand that the perfect setup for both doesn't exist, that like you said, it will be compromise. You can do it. You just explain to them, I'm going to give you, you know, you have to be honest with me. What do you ride more? If you're 70% off-road and 30% track, then that's how we'll bias the setup of your bike. And you have to be willing to give a little on the track to make it work better off-road. And you can get a pretty good setting that does both okay, but a full-on, like a vet expert motocross setup is never going to work that great in the bush, or vice versa. If you're even an expert or an intermediate off-road racer, that setting is going to be different than what's going to work for you on the track. So it's give and take. You can make both work okay, but you can't make both great.
Yeah, cool, man. I like what you said there, how about talking to your customers and educating your customers. Same as with your last answer, you know, because there's a lot of dudes that are good with their hands, maybe even good at running a business and making money, but not that good at talking to their customers. So that that counts for a lot, I think, with what you're doing there. There goes the Colonel again. Did you hear him that tour?
He just agrees with me. He's like, yeah.
He says, fuck it. He's like, fuck you, Geoff. That's it. That's it. Hey, he likes the same music as you too. Yeah.
Good.
Now we're off on a tangent. So Geoff's a big fan of Gangster Rap Friday. That's your jam. It'll be on tomorrow morning.
Producer and, Joe.
That's it. Gangster Rap Friday. The it's on. You can actually look that up on Spotify.
We got and a playlist.
I don't know if that's actually Joe's playlist or it's just one that's very similar, but there is a Gangster Rap Friday.
The Gangster Rap Friday playlist I created. Joe's, all the music that he played on Gangster Rap Fridays is on the main show playlist. So it's just integrated with all the music that he played.
Yeah. Chances are it's pretty similar to the one on Spotify anyway that I've chucked on every now and again. So I'm a rock guy, but I'm pretty partial to a bit of old school rap as well, or very partial to it. And I can tell you that the Colonel, I reckon Cube's his favorite. That's when he's sort of most animated. He gets about the fucking yard a bit when a bit of Cube or a bit of Cypress Hill comes on. So he likes that shit.
The Colonel's not Caucasian, is he?
No. He's red. He's a redhead. He's a redhead, and I believe. I mean, we don't really know. It's not like he came from a fucking school, so we don't know if he came from a breeder or whatever. But he looks like he's a Rhode Island red. That looks like the breed he is. So,
I thought there was a what's the word I'm looking for? There's an old cryptic tale about. One night, a big tornado type storm blew in off the coast with thunder and storms. And it was all, you guys were just cowering in your storm covers in the basement of your house. And then when the sun came out and everything cleared, that the Colonel was just there and he was just delivered by the gods. I thought that's how he came to be.
It's not that. I might just fucking hang it. Remember that. I'll memorize that, and we'll just make that the fucking truth. So what's that thing where if you say something enough, it just fucking becomes a truth? You know,
that's what Kamala Harris does. It's called gaslighting. Is
it? Oh, I don't know who the fuck she is. So anyway, but yeah, there's a thing. You know, it's like there's a name for it where you just say something that so many times it becomes the truth. You know, everyone just believes it because Coming home as a hatchling from a fucking school project isn't as nowhere near as glamorous as a start. So
No, he's too legendary for that.
But the thing is, story. That, sometimes I think that's probably why he's got a fucking chip on his shoulder because he was a school rooster. You know, he wasn't like a fucking hardcore farmyard rooster. So he's got a fucking chip on his shoulder. He's got a fucking he's like a fucking Cooper Webb. He's got that fucking chip on his shoulder. So he's got to perform.
Hey, you just spawned two really good questions that I have for you with those last two things you just said. And so
and that's how the show runs, go for it.
Yeah. And so you did DB kind of dirty and you hit him hard with a question that hit him in the feels. So I got one of those for you.
Oh yeah. I'm all
about that. I'm going to just, this other one's just a quick conversation. I'll hit this first. So you just said Coop. And when you were talking with Brody about Coop and him going to Yamaha, or you were talking about with Bobby Hewitt and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's like, we're all adults. We're all grown men in the room. Why can't people just say they don't like each other? Like, why can't someone just say, I'm the team manager or I'm the team owner, Justin Cooper and I, or pick your rider, Rider Zed, we don't get along. He's not good for the team vibe. So he's as talented as fuck, but we don't want him on the team. Like, that's the truth. But then they just pussyfoot around it and you get the rider humming and hawing, oh, I don't know, I'm just not the right fit, or and then the team owner, and it's like, fuck, just say you guys don't like each other. It's fine.
Yeah. I think that, like, I don't know, man. It's
not a big deal.
It's just our particular sport, but that's just mirroring society, though, isn't it? You know,
yep. Like, yeah. pussyfooting around.
There's not a lot of straight. There's not a lot of straight shooters in the world, you know.
Which is unfortunate.
Yeah.
So my serious question for you, when you're talking with Ben, I don't know how many people caught this, but you threw a little nugget in there. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Nah, man, I don't.
Maybe I took this out of context, but you mentioned something about mental issues.
Yeah, man.
When you guys were talking about the mental game with stuff.
Yeah.
And I took it under the impression that you may have had some battles in the past mentally.
Oh, shit. Yeah, man. So,
can you talk about that?
Oh, fuck. Like, I have talked about it. Yeah. So, on that subject, I'm a fucking open book. Like, fuck it. And I mean, a fucking wide open. If anybody's interested, there is actually at least one video out there that I did a video about my struggles in getting well. And then, and trying to help people. But yeah, man, mental struggles with chronic depression and anxiety from high school age through to my late 30s. And I'm now in my late 40s. So yeah, that was a lot longer time where I was pretty fucked up. And a lot less time now that I've been well. So honestly, man, the story of that is like it, we could do like five fucking episodes on it, in brief, man. So I'll try and give a few nuggets out of that. In brief, it runs in the family very much, which depression usually does. And depression, it's extremely misunderstood. And that's there's like fucking three or four shows in that as well. So,
and anxiety, right?
Yeah. Yep. What I would say to put this into a short thing. So the biggest thing for me that turned my life around, and I also think it's the biggest thing for anybody that's facing those struggles, is about figuring out yourself and being abso-fucking-lutely 1,000,000% authentic and true to yourself, no matter what, and fucking stamp it. Like, no matter what, no matter if it's for fucking money or other people's judgment or fucking anything else, it's about being abso-fucking-lutely yourself. That was the golden nugget that the third shrink that had a crack at my head, she found that. She went digging and she found that nugget, and it flicked a switch on me that that set me on the right path to the man I am today. So, and I am still getting better and gradually getting better. But yeah, man, like I have been very close to being suicidal. I wouldn't say that I have been suicidal, because I never tried anything, but the thoughts and all that sort of thing, I would say if being suicidal is 100, I've spent time at 99. So mental health and the whole thing around that is I'm extremely passionate about, and it would be something that I am equally as passionate. So Moto and helping people with those struggles would be my two biggest passions, man. So yeah, and absolutely fucking completely open to talk about it. So even to the stage that if someone listens to this show and they're struggling, hit me up. I'll fucking definitely answer, and I will definitely be able to give you some help. And particularly if you're a dad, if you're a bloke, if you're a bloke like me, you know, who's a bit fucking a free bird, loose unit type, you know, I can definitely help you out with that. So yeah, man. And fucking thanks for asking too, because you know, it's a great subject. I actually love talking about it.
Good.
And I'll try and figure out how I can maybe link the video I'm talking about. I did 5 or 6 years ago, maybe ish. I basically put out a video on Facebook to all my family and friends explaining what I'd been going through. And before that day where I hit fucking send on that video, only my wife and my doctor knew that I'd ever not been this fucking happy, smiling fucker that you're looking at right now. Because I was still the happy, smiling fucker, you know? So AKA your Robin Williams type. Yep. The fucking happy guy, nothing's ever wrong with Steve, you know, all that sort of thing.
Yep.
I was one of those guys. Yeah. So, but like I said, man, yeah.
You could do
5 episodes on that.
You mentioned something about giving supporting other people or other kids or dudes or whatever. Like, do you find, whether it's coaching or whatever, giving back to the riding community is like obsessive, almost infectious, that like once you start, you can't stop kind of thing?
The way I live my life nowadays is like I try and help people all the time, you know. And I fucking love it, you know. Like when before I had the courage to do a video and say, look, this is me, I've been all fucked up, blah blah blah, and put that out to the world, you know, that before that, like, it's amazing the amount of people that just that one act, the ripple effect of that. Me and my best mates now, since I did that video, who are, and some of them are fucking, your real alpha, macho, fucking, you know, like the last cunt you'd expect to talk about their feels. We will talk to each other about how we're going now since I fucking cracked that open. My dad, who's the most stoic motherfucker you'd ever come across, we'll talk about our feels, you know, all that sort of thing. So, and you know, as far as, you know, helping people, I'll go out of my way, go very much out of my way to help people out with that. Even to the stage where, man, I tried to maybe get a foot in the door of working in that space because I love it so much. But not to get political, but that field of mental health in general, I don't fit in with that crowd. So, which is fucking shame because, you know, Bogans.
They need a good cunt like you.
But
that's why it's a shame.
Bogans know about this stuff too. But yeah, it's it is very much a and I've spoken to some people, you know, that are doing great things in that sort of space of mental health and that, and they say, yeah, you know, like we need blokes like you in this space because there's blokes like you that fucking struggle with things and won't talk about it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I sort of give up on that. And but not, you never give up completely. But as far as just, I'm just happy, man, to informally help people because I've learned so much. You know, like I took it upon myself to because, you know, and we got this in common. I think a lot of moto people got this in common. I don't trust the narrative on anything. I've got to investigate and figure it out myself.
Yep.
I'll talk to the doctor. And I'll do my own research, and I'll talk to the shrinks, and I'll do my own research and that sort of thing, and come up with what's best for me, and really learn about me. And I think that's a real key to health in general, especially mental health, is you know, the core of it, listening to yourself. So,
educating yourself.
Absolutely, I educated myself on, you know, like I was a guy who could, and this is a cut. This is coming back to me. This is a cut out of the video I was speaking of. I'm a guy who can fix anything, you know, fix cars, bikes, houses, you fucking name it. I can fix anything and everything. And I sort of took it on myself. I was like, fuck this. I'm going to fix my fucking head. And I fucking did, you know, as I've said to people, like, I don't know, I think black dog isn't just an Australian term. I think the black dog is a worldwide term as far as depression.
Yep.
You know, I kick the fucking black dog's ass. So.
Yep. So yeah. Do you feel like, I know you say that it's hereditary, but like, do you feel like your relationship with your dad or how your dad, and in no way am I blaming him or anything, but how he managed or carried himself or his relationship with you, do you feel like you changing that relationship in how you engage and act with your son will have a positive or profound effect on the possible outcomes with your son?
Massively. Already has.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Massively. Yeah. So my son and my daughter have both had struggles.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to pick up on what was going on straight away. Earlier for my, my son's nearly 21.
Yep.
So early days, I hadn't figured my own shit out. So, and it breaks my heart that I didn't have that knowledge earlier for him. But I had that knowledge for when my daughter had some struggles. Mm-hmm. Her struggles, nothing like what I've been through. My son had heavy, heavy struggles. My daughter just had, you know, teenage girls have heaps of struggles, you know.
100%.
But I was there with fucking heaps of knowledge to help. You know, and as a dad, man, like I've never had money, man. Like I don't complain about it because there's many people in the world that are fucking that my life would be like fucking royalty to.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never had much money. I'm not going to be able to leave my kids much money, but mm-hmm. I'm able to leave my kids a fucking lot of good advice, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So,
but isn't that's of more value in the real world, right?
Well, one thing I say is, if there's always a way, if you really wanted to make money, there's a way to do that. But what you can't get, you can't just get, you know, you can't get just get, you can't go and buy wisdom. Someone has to
give it to you. Or happiness or mental stability.
Yeah, that's right. And the other thing is too, you can't get back time. So the sooner you are, learn about yourself and you're healthy and you're ready to live the life that you're supposed to fucking live, that authentic life, that it's saving your time, which is fucking heaps more valuable than money. So.
I had a good friend of mine's dad said something to me once that stuck into my head forever. He said, I look forward to the day that I can stop being his father and just be his friend.
Mm.
And as your son grows, right, and becomes a man himself, right, your role as a father, you'll always be his father. Don't get me wrong, but you don't raise him as a dad anymore. You're just his buddy. Yours should be his best buddy, right?
Yeah. Well, that's like, you might remember, we talked a little bit about that sort of stuff with DB was talking about Evan.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. That's what sparked it for me.
You know, like, yeah, like my dad's my best mate nowadays, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, my young bloke has autism. So it's different, man, because all autistic people, they communicate on a different level, you know, to others. Their normals are different normal, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the time that close connection's not there because that's just how they roll.
Yep.
But I fucking love it when, you know, usually when we spend a lot of time, when he's sort of stuck with me, you know, if in the winter time he'll come out with me, we'll go cutting firewood. Our house is wood heated, you know?
Yep.
We'll go cutting firewood. And he'll be stuck with me for like a whole day, you know, and he has to, and he'll start talking and we'll have these great conversations and things like that. So, you know, and yeah, so the relationship's different, but yeah, we're great mates. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
That's pretty important.
It is, man. It is. Hey, do you want to do some more suspension questions, or you know? So as we planned earlier, and it's just gone organically that way, which is cool. It's how I like it. But Geoff wanted to ask me some questions, and we've sort of already gotten into that. Do you want to do a couple more suspension questions, and then we can jump back to questions you had for me? And
yeah, yeah. I want to talk a little bit of current events with this whole Ducati Triumph thing that we got going on. But
yeah, man, go for it.
Yeah, yeah, ask me a suspension question.
Yeah,
or whatever maybe works.
We'll do a couple of suspension questions, man. Yeah, we'll do a couple more, or maybe even one more. It depends how interesting it is for you.
Yeah,
and, you know, what we get out of it. One that I was going to ask about that I think so many people don't know, and this is, again, out to the average Joes. This is, you know, RH22, he knows all this, but average Joe is about just the right, you know, having your forks installed properly. Not just fucking cranking the fucking triple clamp bolts down and fucking everything, talking them right, talking them to, again, like I know, riding a Cowie, I always thought the Cowie specs on the triple clamps, the fucking bolts were just too tight, but I did them with the specs. And then it was only just a couple of years ago, you know, knowing RH22, I said, dude, what are you guys, and that was quite a bit less, you know, yeah. It was about 10-15% less torque than the Cowie book says. And you know, there you go. Because I mean, I've had to replace the bolts because the bolts stretch. I fucking even snapped one time when I was doing it to the, you know, things like that. And getting your fork set in, and you know, I think everyone's got their certain things. I learned off a guy, you know, put it back down the ground, bounce it, you know, all this sort of stuff, retorque it, you know, this sort of thing. And even you like your front wheel, people crank up, yeah, you know, and fucking twist the forks, you know, together like this, that sort of stuff. Do you find you have to explain that to a lot of customers, or do you just explain it now, how you do it?
Again, this is all circles back to educating your customer. If they're the type of person, I mean, that does their own work at home, a lot of customers bring me loose forks and shocks, right? And then a lot of customers bring me the bike. And I used to want to have the bike so that when I did work to their suspension and it got reinstalled in the bike, I wanted to make sure that those triple clamps were torqued correctly and the axle lugs were torqued correctly. So that, and then the forks, we'll get into this in a second, that they were parallel. And so that the work that I did with valving or spring rates and the suspension worked the way I wanted it to, so that the customer yielded the effect that we were looking for. If they install it incorrectly, then that wrecks all of that. So for a while, I used to not charge people to do it just to make sure that they weren't being reluctant to bring me the bike because of money. I wanted to make sure it was done right. But then I'm doing an extra 45 minutes or hour worth of work, re-ring forks and shocks for free. And at some point, like, it doesn't say UNICEF across the top of the door. It says GPMoto, right? So my time's worth money. I'm sorry, but it is. I need to make a living. So I had to start charging people to re-enry forks and shocks. Some people still bring me their bikes and some people bring me loose suspension. And some people install their stuff incorrectly and I fix it for them. But it happens for sure. And if I could even do my best to keep this super short, but if you can imagine with a conventional, like an inverted fork that we have on almost all our modern dirt bikes, there's a bushing that goes around the top of the inner tube. Okay. It's called the piston bushing. So it slides up inside the ID of your outer aluminum tube. And then there's a bushing that gets hammered into the bottom of your outer tube and it stays still. And as the inner tube moves in and out of the outer tube, that bushing just helps, you know, keep everything in place. So your very top triple clamp, if you over torque the shit out of it, it doesn't really matter. You're just pinching the fork tube around the fork cap, basically. But that lower triple clamp, or your lower crown, whatever you want to call it, that piston bushing that's on the inner fork tube, it has to pass through your triple clamp as your suspension compresses. So when you over tighten it, you create a stiction point that will create harshness in your suspension before your suspension bottoms out.
Yeah.
So that torque is important. And you're right. Most guys over torque it. And even some manufacturer specs, I think I'm glad that your gut told you it was too high. It probably was, right? Like you say, RH and other guys aren't tightening them that tight.
Yeah.
Before I get to the last point, the other one is a lot of guys don't vent the air pressure out of their right out of their forks. I've had forks that they barely compress. They feel like garbage. And you bleed the air out of them with a screwdriver and all of a sudden they're magic again. They're nice and plush. So simple stuff like that. But then
that,
the last
one blows me away. That one blows me away. Like, geez, every single ride, like, you know, or even during a ride, if it's really long, like, I'll do that. Like, even at my, like, I'm like a mid pack at best C grader, right? So my pace is not great. But that's how much I love the sport, man, to be still riding at my age, but I've never gotten good. You know, that really shows the love. But I can notice when the forks, when the air's pumped up, you know?
Yep. Yeah. 100%. Yeah. And then the last one that you mentioned is a lot of guys change their own tires, right? Yeah. So the front axle's in and out and they're constantly over torquing the shit out of those fork lugs at the bottom. Right. A little tighter, a little tighter, snug it up a little more. Right. And it just crushes that axle lug around the axle.
Yeah.
And then when that starts getting tight, then guys, out comes the hammer to start beating the axle in. Well, then it mushrooms over the end of the axle. Yeah. Right. And they don't notice. Well, then your axle is not going into the fork lug where it should, but you still tighten up the nut on the other side. So it literally takes the fork tubes and it pulls them together in the bottom. So now your forks aren't parallel anymore. They're like, I'm exaggerating, but they're in like a V down towards the front wheel. So you get tons of stiction and binding in your bushings. And so I was having a conversation with one of the very high ups at Race Tech in California one time. And they were talking about issues with customers complaining about the quality, like they bought gold valves, they installed them. It just doesn't work the way they thought it was going to. So what they did is they hired somebody, they put them in a van, like a sprinter van or whatever. And they had them drive around. They followed the national circuit in the United States. And there's always usually amateur races that correspond with the pro races on a weekend. And all this guy's job was, all he did is he would walk around the pits and look for guys that had Race Tech stickers on their forks. And all he'd do is he'd find someone with Race Tech decals, walk up to them, introduce himself, and just check that fork lugs. Just make sure that the forks are centered on the axle properly, that it's not binding on the front. And I forget the number now. This was years ago we had this talk, but they had something crazy like a 38 or 40% reduction in technical assistance calls after they hired him and had him doing that.
Yeah, that's honestly, man, like that's unreal, but it also doesn't surprise me.
Totally.
It doesn't surprise me. Yeah.
And I mean, yesterday I put an axle in my lathe and I machined off the mushroom tip on an axle on a 2013 KX450. Like, I still see it all the time.
That's wild. Now, I haven't seen that, but look, I've seen, you know, we've all seen the hack jobs, you know. It's like,
yeah.
I mean, yeah, I was never a motorcycle mechanic apart from, well, I've been working on my own bike since I was about 12, but I was a general stream mechanic. So I worked on cars, and you see, I've seen so much rough stuff. Yeah. The old the hammer, you need the hammer sometimes. Some things you do need a hammer, but a lot of things don't ever fucking pick up the hammer. So,
It's amazing how many guys don't have a rubber hammer or a soft blow hammer in their toolbox.
Yeah.
I mean, you could beat it till you're blue in the face with that if you want, but just don't use a metal hammer.
Yeah, the old nylon one. That's my favorite when you got to give something a bit of a tune up. Yeah.
Yep. Absolutely.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Cool. One more suspension question. Hey.
Yep.
So, do you get, when you get average Joe come in, and they're trying to explain to you what they want. So I'm very good with this. Okay. Yep. So, and I know I even get people like suspension texts. They were like, fucking thank me. Cause I'll do a fucking list. I'll be like, this is what I ride, this percentage of moto, this percentage of off-road. This is exactly what I weigh with gear on. I like to ride up over the front and you know, get over the front wheel as a rider and blah, 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 a couple other things. And they'll be like, oh, shit, fucking yeah, this is good. Yeah, this makes it easy.
100%.
And I remember one guy asked me what I weighed about three times, you know, just because he was obviously used to people fucking lying.
Lying.
Yeah, there's so many people. And that was when I was fat too, you know. And a lot of fat guys would be lying. Yeah, they'd be shaving a few often and not look so bad.
Yeah.
But that's no good because they want to set your bike up properly.
Yeah,
right. Got to get the fat boy springs in.
I keep a scale.
Go? Like you must get a lot of people that just, you know, wouldn't have, can't explain what they want and that sort of thing. That'd be pretty hard at times.
You'd be surprised. I'm going to do myself a huge disservice here. And I don't know, maybe not, but I do a lot of testing. Every, like, 2024 is now, they have a new coil fork out from WP. So all the Austrian bikes have a new fork they've released. So the second I can get my hands on one, I do, I ride it, I valve it. I establish some base settings that's going to work. Again, the majority of my clientele base is around here. So I find good settings that work around here. And then that way I've got that as like a good database to work from. And then, like you say, if you're 20 or 30 pounds heavier or lighter, then you can, over the years, you learn how to make a slight variation on the mid valve or on the base valve or spring rate and stuff to ensure that you're giving the rider what you want. But yeah, I get guys, I've got customers that are 6'8", 280, and I've got customers that are 5'3", and they're 120 pounds. And they both exhibit their own challenges with setup. But where I'm going to discredit myself a bit here is, with those base settings that I've established as a good setting, you would be surprised that for 90% of the people out there, I could put the exact same valving in their forks and shocks and just change the spring rate based on their weight. And 90% of those people will be ecstatic with the end result. Could it be better than that? Possibly. But are you willing to spend the money to have me go in there two or three or four times and make subtle changes to get it as good as it could possibly be? Or are you happy with the 70% improvement that we made over stock with those base settings, right? So I don't always do that. I'm not saying that that's my business motto. It's not, but I'm saying that you almost could. So most off-road guys are pretty, they just want plushness on square edges. They want the bike to hold itself up, not squat excessively on corner exit or dive too much under the brakes. And if you can kind of nail those three things, most people are going to be pretty happy with their setup. Then you get that last 10% that are good. Like you say, they're really good at interpreting feedback from the bike and translating that to you into when and where it will do what. And so then you can use those symptoms to help tune the fork or shock to get it to do what they're looking for. And again, when you see it over and over and over and over again, most people are realistically, they're looking for the same thing. So if one person says, oh, your revalve was amazing, when they bring it in for a service again 50 hours later, they're like, hey, it just dives a little bit more than I'd like on the fork, could we just fix that? Then that same fix you used on the last person that didn't like the dive, 9 times out of 10 you could put that fix in this again and it works for this person too. So there's a lot of repetition. RH22, could we've talked about valving settings quite a bit on conversations we've had, and I think there's a lot of pros that ride similar settings, but then there's pros, again, kind of world renowned known, that Ricky Carmichael's setup was completely fucked, that nobody else could ride his bike, right?
Yeah.
And same with Reed, his was different maybe, or, you know, whereas I feel like someone like Brayton would ride a pretty neutral setting. Yeah. So none of those settings are wrong. If Ricky goes undefeated 2 years in a row, his bike's not wrong. It's just, it's wrong for you, but it's right for him.
Yeah.
So it gets, you start getting into some thick stuff there with what's right and what's wrong with suspension settings. But I feel sorry for the manufacturer, because now that I know what goes into setting up a fork and a shock in terms of spring rate and valving settings and everything, to try to put something in there that's going to make all the consumers happy, plus Chris Kiefer and Michael Lindsay and whoever, whatever editor of, or of whatever magazine that's, oh, it's a piece of shit, it's too soft, it's too stiff, right? Like, who do you cater to?
Yeah.
Right. And I don't know, my theory is they don't cater to the pros because no pro run stock suspension. They don't cater to the beginner because they don't know what the fuck they're doing anyways. You know what I mean? They're sensory overload. Yeah. And so they're really catering to like the average junior to intermediate vet pro kind of speed. As long as it works good for them, that's kind of who they want to keep happy. So I guess based on the settings I see.
Cool, man. Cool. That's some good information there. So that also matches what I've heard from quite a few is spring rates, along with just keeping your shit in good condition with your oil and everything nice, is the key that you don't always need a revalve. Yeah.
Yes and no. No, you don't always. I agree with what you're saying. But the reality that the amount of times that a stock suspension setting will work for the customer, I would say, is probably 2 out of 10.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Just because too many variables, right?
Yeah.
Again, that depends where you live and what you're doing with the bike, what model bike you bought. If you bought an SXF, then it's not going to work off road. That's not what it's meant for. Whereas an XCW or a, you know what I mean, a YZF 450X or whatever, they're off road models. They'll work better off road. But the other thing I wanted to quickly say too was a lot of guys, whether it's your, and I'm not picking on Chris Kiefer, he's great, he does an amazing job, but they always talk about how important it is to set sag on your bike. Yes, it is, but it's also just as important to fuck with it. Don't just set it at 105 or 103 and never touch it again because that's what they said. What does 108 feel like? What does 100 feel like? You know what I mean? Classic was when, this is years ago, and Justin Barsha and Aaron Plessinger both rode for Factory Yamaha. I can't remember what, if it was Transworld or maybe it was SwapMoto or who it was, but they rode both their bikes. And Plessinger's bike's super choppered out. He probably runs 108, 110 sag, really deep in the back. And Barsha's rides like 98 or 100 mil sag, the thing's on its nose. And that's just their riding style. And again, back to what I said about Reed versus Carmichael or whatever, neither of those setups are wrong. That's just what that rider prefers. One guy steers with the front wheel, one guy steers with the rear wheel. So how do you know what you like until you try both and say, I do like this or I don't like that? But if you never fuck with it, then you never know what works for you. So don't be afraid to play with compression settings. Don't be afraid to play with sag.
Do you have a go-to sag that what's your go-to starting point with sag?
105 usually.
Yeah, cool. Well, that's what I do. So. That's
all right. Yeah. And then play from
as long as Susie gets it right, because she's the sag measure in this
family. Yeah.
I can't get much
past Aussie Susie. She's on.
I think
it.
Her eyes are pretty good. So she's, I leave the fucking Sharpie mark on the fucking back guards of both my bikes. So it's ready to, makes it easy. Yeah, that's it.
Hey, so what do you, did you see that release they just did with the Ducati?
I've seen the video where, it's a shadowy blacked out. You can't see anything. And I did happen across a picture that was on Insta. I think it was Motocross Action put up, but I didn't take too much into it because a lot of these pictures that come out that are like
Photoshopped
bullshit. Yeah, Photoshop bullshit. I sort of looked at it and I thought, I don't know if that's fucking right or not. So
Ducati itself has released a really cool 3D animated, like a computer rendering of the engine, putting it together, assembling itself piece by piece.
I saw the start of it when I was probably when I was having Smoko or something today, and so just explain Smoko. I don't know if that's just, I think that's just an Aussie thing. I don't smoke. Smoko is just a nickname for morning tea.
Or
your morning break.
A smoke break.
From way but from no the smoke. Old days when everybody was using it to have a smoke, it's called Smoko. So if an Aussie says they're taking Smoko, they're taking morning tea or afternoon tea or whatever, you know, you're having your small breaks at work. That's the thing. So not every Aussie smokes. Not many Aussies do smoke. It's a pretty small population nowadays. So
good.
But yeah, that's just a little Aussie term, something that, I'm just learning you something there. But I did see the start of that Ducati engine
animation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but where I was working today, the internet was fucking shit. So it wouldn't load and that sort of thing. So I fucked it off and so I have to go back and watch it. I think Toolman Dan put it up, didn't he, or shared it?
Yeah, there was, it's going around. It's the latest thing. So for me, it was as a mechanic, and it was really intriguing because it's tough for me to see it through the lens of the average consumer who, politely as I can say this, doesn't know anything about the internals of engines. But like RH or myself, I recognize and know every single part and piece that they were putting together in that animation. And I'm picking up from, I guess we didn't get into this with my past, but I spent 5 or 6 years road racing down in Portland, Oregon. And so with my street bike background, I'm quite familiar with Ducati and their desmodromic valve train system. I watched MotoGP religiously for a lot of years in the early 2000s through till, I don't know, probably from 01 to like 2012, probably a good 10 years. And went to a few GPs and stuff. But so this desmodromic valve train system that they're going to have in these engines, I don't know if you know anything about this or not, but basically there's no valve spring.
Okay.
Okay. So if you imagine, a rocker arm, you have a rocker arm on the top, there's your valve and there's a rocker arm on the top of the valve to push the valve open.
The rocker pulls the valve back out.
There's two rockers. There's one rocker that's like a finger or a finger follower, they call it. That pushes the valve open. And then they have a V one that hooks under the valve and it closes it. So there's no valve spring.
Okay. Yeah.
And there's two lobes on the cam for each valve. One's an opening lobe and one's a closing lobe.
So we got a couple of mechanics going now. So some people might be like, what the fuck are these guys talking about? But just listen, you might learn something. So if that valve's getting pulled, does it still have a tapered seat, like a normal tapered seat on the
100%.
Valve?
Yep.
Geez, that sort of blows me away that it's, the adjustment on that must be really fucking perfect to not be, you know, so I can imagine that adjustment gets out and it's just ripping the heads off valves, yeah?
Well, the problem is you have valve clearance, which normally all you're setting is the clearance between the tip of the valve and the opening, the finger follower that's opening it. But now you have valve clearance you need to set on the closing arm as well. So you have two valve clearances to check on each valve. And there's a spec, and it's even tighter, like you say, on those two. So what I was about to get into with my rant here is that there's no question, performance-wise, that the desmodromic valve train system is more efficient than a spring-type valve, or using a mechanical coil spring to close the valve.
Yeah.
What you can do now is rev this engine higher because the chance of valve float where the cam has pushed the valve open, and as the cam goes to allow the valve to close, sometimes the cam will travel away from the valve faster than the valve can stay attached to the cam. So then you get what's called valve float, where the valve's just kind of floating in thin air. Nothing's touching it.
And she starts to get all fluffy and
But then instead of following a nice, the ramp or the closing profile of the camshaft, instead of closing the valve in a nice controlled manner, it's just the spring snapping the valve shut as fast as it can. And when it hits the seat, it usually bounces open again.
Yeah.
And so with the desmodromic valve train system, it can't happen. That valve is being closed in a controlled manner with that rocker arm, and it's being opened in a controlled manner. So that valve, it's always being controlled in every state of its travel. So it doesn't matter. Like, you can rev it as high as you want. You'll never get valve float. So that's where we see on the MotoGP circuit that the Ducatis have 17, 18,000 RPM rev ceilings.
Yeah.
So yeah. I'm not arguing that fact at all. That's science. It's happening. Like, this is going to bump the rev ceiling of a 450 motocrosser significantly higher than what we currently have.
I can see benefit 250 benefits more than anything.
So when's the last time
450 is already fast enough, you know? Like, you know, but the 250 benefits, that's huge.
Well, Chad from XPR put a post up with the thing, and I made a comment on his post about when's the last time you heard a guy riding a 450 going, "Fuck, I wish this thing just revved like 4,000 RPM higher." Right? Like, you don't need it.
450, yeah.
But on a 250, I think it's totally valid.
Because Ducati are coming in with a 450, aren't they?
Yes.
Yeah, whereas Triumph are coming in with a 250, which is funny. It made me laugh that Ducati coming in with a 450, it's so Italian. It's such an Italian thing to do. Like, my best mates are Italian boys. And I love Italian culture, it makes me laugh so much. Like, everything, it's all bigger,
bravado,
faster, flasher, better. Like, it's all like, there's no, like, you know, like my best mate went from an 80 as a kid that his dad had, and then as soon as he was an adult, he bought a 650, you know. It was like, fuck all that stuff in between. Like, you know, he went from a KX80, and then when it was first bike as an adult, he's like, he went and bought a KLX650. I don't know if you remember those fucking tanks, but yeah, that was his bike.
So good.
You know, and it's all like, you know, all the Italian boys, they're all like, you know, the biggest, fastest, you know, it's just that, you know, that mentality. It makes
big, so
it
made me laugh.
Such an Italian thing to do for the, this is like, well, fuck, we're not fucking around with 250s here, you know, that's all, we're just going straight to the big stuff.
Yeah,
it's awesome.
I mean, but here's the thing though, they're claiming with race exhaust 85 horse.
Yeah, which is, that's a thing that the road race, that great for road racing, more power. But yeah,
totally.
450s, they don't need more power. They need, you know, like, you would have heard about Kiefer Road Jets bike.
Yep.
Which won everything this year. And it was like really smooth. It was obviously fast as fuck because all the 450s are fast as fuck, and those Hondas are an animal. But it was like, it was really manageable power for a 450, you know? And like, Kiefer again rode Kenny's bike recently. And Kenny, he said the same thing about Kenny's bike, you know? Pretty sort of manageable. So, you know, probably the only one out there that's like, give me all the power. Probably someone like Barsha is probably like, yeah, just give me all that power.
Right?
Give me those revs.
Yeah.
But for most of them, and you know, that's the absolute best in the world. So we don't need more power out of a 450. But you know, unless maybe super deep, what's the Belgian?
Oh, Lommel.
Yes. Maybe in a deep Lommel, that might 100%. Be an advantage. It's something like that, because you just, the power sapping of a track like that is massive.
And the elite level rider, like you say, a Barsha or somebody who can actually screw it to the stop and hold it there.
Yeah.
But
it'll be an animal. It'll be a desert racing animal if it's, you know, like, our races like Fink and Hatter over here, like that's which that's all stuff where Toby Price cut his teeth before he got into the rally bikes.
Yeah, 100%.
It'd be an animal in that because they do have like a 450s and 500s like on the limiter for
yep
for like you know there's a Deez. Video out there somewhere of Pricey pre-running Fink and he's on a KTM 500 obviously tweaked to all hell geared up to all hell and you know they're probably I don't know what do they do they'd be well in your speak or you can
I'm saying as you kilometers
you know metric but you yep. know they're probably doing 170 so what's that 105 mm-hmm. mile an hour or something
yep
and there's a video out there of Pricey on the limiter in top and I think it goes for a full minute at Fink and yeah you'd be able to find it easy enough if you want to see it and it's just like the shit's just blur it's just blurring past you know
that poor engine
I remember when he first posted it and some dumbass is like oh that's obviously fake you know that's definitely not real you know you can tell that that's just been fake sped up and all that so I think it was like oh no that's what this guy does so
yeah that's because they can't see the size of his balls swinging underneath.
I don't know how he gets any fucking pants to fit that guy. Like, he is, you know, like I put Pricey, as much as I'm a huge motocross fan, I love the off-road racing as well. But off-road's just not accessible to watch, you know?
No.
No. But as far as Aussie legends on two wheels, like Pricey, he's the fucking top. For me and for a lot of people, like above the road race guys, above Chad, all that, like, yeah, Toby is the fucking man, you know. And I think his personality also,
a
lot comes from that too. So,
well, back to what you asked Ben about, if you're going on a road trip and picking three mates to bring with you, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys both said Price or he'd be one of the boys to bring with you. So
yeah, that's right. Yeah, he said for us like in Australia, if you're talking Aussies, absolutely. Like I know I've been asked the Mount Rushmore question, you know, the old Mount Rushmore question of Aussie Moto before. And it's really fucking hard to pick the fourth guy. But I said, look, because Toby grew up racing Moto, like I think he was a national champion in junior classes.
Yep.
And actually, I've got a magazine over in my collection here somewhere, and there's the cover. It says something like Toby Price. Where did he come from? And it's when he first turned up to race off road and just fucking waxed everybody. So when he made the transition, but I said, you know, he started in moto, so he, you know, there's him, him, and then Chad. And this was a while ago. This was before Jet was doing, you know, Jet things and that now. And I think I said Medi, and then the fourth one was really hard. And there was a bit of a discussion on that. They sort of throw a blanket over a few.
Yeah.
But he's definitely an absolute legend. Where he grew up too, like, you know, when you guys when people think of like the Aussie outback, the classic Aussie outback, like in the picture in the corner of me. Actually, of what this guy made, Down Up Design. He's the man. Down Up Design, Kurt Evans. He did the cartoons for me logo. He's the man. He just sent me a heap of cool stickers and merch and all this sort of stuff. Shout out to him. That sort of desert scene, that's where Toby grew up. A place called Hillston, which is like, if you left from where I live, so I sort of live right in the middle of all different landscapes. So basically, if you head sort of straight northwest from me, you're into the red sand, and then it doesn't fucking stop. So it doesn't stop for, you could drive for days and you're still in red sand, you know? So he lives up into this, basically in the New South Wales outback where he grew up there. And you know, like there's a supermarket up there in a town just south of his town. There's a supermarket up there, that's got a Toby Price winning Fink rally bike.
Sweet.
Mounted up above the produce section. So you got your fucking yogurt and your cheese and all that there, and then Toby Price's bike's fucking sitting up there.
It's that's awesome.
The guy that owns it is a cool cat. He's a super moto freak. So,
yeah. That's so rad when people are so passionate about riding that are involved in different industries like that, like own grocery stores or own hotel chains or something like that. And then you just get that sprinkle of moto mixed in there. It's pretty sweet.
Yeah. Well, this guy's actually got all these, not all, because he's got, he told me once how many he had, but he's got a heap of vintage bikes, his vintage Bull Tacos and stuff mounted up in on display in his supermarket. And you guys call him a supermarket, grocery store,
supermarket.
But yeah, and right at the front of the produce aisle there is this fucking Toby's bike on display.
It's just so good.
So cool.
How many bikes do you have in your garage right now?
Me? I was asked this recently and I did a count up. So including like ones that are completely apart and have been apart for years, there's 10 at the moment. Mm-hmm. Ones that I could start and ride like right now. Four.
Yeah.
And two vintage bikes that are a fair way into restoration.
Mm-hmm.
And then the others torn to bits or not even started to work on, you know. So I've rescued a few bikes here and there, whereas like, I felt sorry for them, you know. I'll do that sometimes. I feel like
taking in stray dogs.
Exactly. It's like I don't even know why, but my local dealer had an old XR250 traded in, and I don't really have sort of any interest in that, but he said, look, this thing's so bad, and he goes, you can have it, and he gave me like a ridiculously cheap price, and he goes, I just want it to go to someone that'll, you know, give it some love. And I was like, all right, fuck it.
What year is it?
It's a 2001. And
it's a newer one.
So, yeah. Well, it's one of the sort of that same red look one that they were right till they disappeared and the CRF 250X took over.
Yeah.
And I brought it home and, I've got pictures of the sprockets and the air filter and stuff. And it's just like the air filter was just one of them ones where it just like just disintegrated in your hand.
Yep.
And the sprocket teeth are like all just like the full fucking hook, man. You know, it's like, and all that. And it's just, it's not even started. It's just sitting there. It's like, it's about fourth or fifth down the list.
Yeah.
That's a passion, you know, but it's extremely time consuming and it's fucking expensive
doing it's therapy
motocross bikes. Yeah. But that's my holiday, man. Like if I get a chance, so I really only get a lot of work done on these bikes when I take some time off at Christmas. So that's one, there's a difference. Aussies tend to, I think you guys have a summer break in the middle of the year. Yeah.
Yep.
Or at least your schools do. You probably don't have to work through it, but that's Christmas for us. So a lot of you know, especially people like me that work in trades or construction, as you guys say, we'll basically knock off on the Christmas Eve or a couple of days earlier if you're lucky, if you're caught up enough. And then we'll take, you know, 2, 3, 4, whatever you can afford, basically.
Yeah.
Weeks off, and that'll be sort of our holidays for the year. And I will, once you get all the family Christmas shit down out of the way, I always say Boxing Day is my fucking day. And I'm in the shed. I'm in the shed and I'm fucking playing with my bikes. And that's it. I'm disappeared into the shed for a couple of weeks.
And just some cold ones.
Tinker with the bikes.
You just got Creed on 10, right? Some cold beer. Just you and Scott Stapp. Just make sweet love music to bikes.
There's always music going, man. Yeah. You know, Creed has made since since the whole Creed thing with main event, like, yeah, I do have some Creed on the Spotify list, you know, which I never even had that on there when they were new, you know. But
I'm not gonna lie, when I have customers in the shop and I got my playlist going and then some Creed comes on, part of me is a little embarrassed.
yeah but you got to embrace it though. That's
you got, yeah, you have to,
you got to embrace it. Yeah
yep.
And you know what the funny thing is, man, like I genuinely do like some of the songs now. Yep. Like, you know, I genuinely do like it, and I think, like, why did we give them such a fucking hard time back in the day? Why were they so uncool in their heyday, you know, as a, you know, like when you were sort of like, I was like a fucking hard rock guy and before that, like a grunge guy. And then before that, again, a hard rock guy. And it was like, they were just sort of like, oh, I don't know about these guys.
But you just said it, like, compared to some of
fucking, they're actually pretty good. Like, you know, he's a fucking great singer and they're a good band and all that. And it's just, you know, I don't know, but yeah.
Yeah, but compared to some of the grunge stuff that was out there, some of the Metallica and Soundgarden and some of this, you know what I mean, hard rock, Godsmack and stuff, like, he's just a big fucking pussy.
Yeah, that's right.
Like,
yeah, that's
it's Chad Kruger. Like, he's the Nickelback of the States.
Yeah, I've never come around to Nickelback. Definitely. I'm Team Stapp. I'm definitely Team Stapp. That's it.
Yeah.
Righto, guys, cool your jets for a bit. We decided to make this a part one, and there'll be a part two for the episode with Canada Geoff. We ended up talking a long time, and so that'll suit the time frames that I'm hoping to keep these shows to. It was a nice idea by Geoff he wanted to ask me questions, which we spoke about before the show. Geoff mentioned that there's probably some listeners, or hopefully there is, who know fuck all about me. So he said, you know, I should talk a little bit more about what makes me tick. So hopefully that's not too boring. And obviously, yeah, I also asked Geoff, as you've heard, I'll ask Geoff questions about what he's up to. So hold tight, and there will be a part two coming soon. Cheers.
This?
That's the Mississippi, the mighty Mississippi, the old miss, the old man.